and allow you to take advantage of the scalability and distributed training that, of course, hardware today enables to speed up your development time. We don't want you to spend any time on DevOps, so your focus should solely be as a scientist or data scientists and research engineers on training and model training. The other thing that I also mentioned earlier is we want you to have total infrastructure freedom. You should, and this actually applies to the framework as well. As I said, it can be TensorFlow, Keras, Caffe, whatever is a PyTorch, whatever is your favorite framework. And in fact, in infrastructure-wise, we also allow you to have any type of infrastructure you want. You want it to be in any of the cloud platforms. You want it to be on-premise. Our platform allows for all of that, and you will see how. So basically, there's very simplistically these four layers of our product stack. The apps layer doesn't belong to us. You bring in your favorite, as I said, framework, or it can actually be your own libraries as well there. Interface, we have three interfaces right now to our platform. One is command line. I will demo that later. The other is API. I won't demo that. And the third is a SaaS, so it's a web-based GUI that you can use to train your models. In fact, I actually, on my way here, started a few training processes on my phone, distributed the TensorFlow. So you will see that in a minute, or in a few minutes. And in terms of operating system level, all the things that, again, we don't want the data scientist or researcher to worry about in terms of containerization, Kubernetes is here, but we're also developing support for Docker, firewalling, access control, monitoring, job management, SDN, all of this is taken care of by the +1 platform. And you will see that a bit later. As I said, infrastructure-wise, can be your own favorite compute infrastructure or on-premise. Storage-wise, again, we're storage agnostic. And artifacts as well, we want to be agnostic to where your code and other resources are gathered from, if you want to connect it to. And we're in the sort of group exercise we'll do later, we'll pull code from GitHub and you will see how that's done. So that's a platform. And as you can see already here, it's not really limited to deep learning. Whatever app layer you want to introduce or connect to, we support that. So it's not just deep learning. Obviously, the real strength of it, as you will see, is when you run deep learning at scale. All right, so let me actually switch to the demo part, and then we'll go through this workshop because we can start some jobs in parallel. Okay, so +1. Let me see, let me log out so you can see exactly how this is done. All right, so I don't know if any of you have done this before, but if you haven't, I suggest you register an account. So you would go here to create, and fill in the info and you should be ready to go after that. And then I'll give you a few minutes to do that. And then you log in. So, the very first thing you should do after you log in, and most of you are probably not there yet, is you should connect your GitHub, because we're gonna, in the demo, we're gonna pull code from GitHub, not your GitHub, but from GitHub, so you might as well do that. And the way you do it, you know that you go to settings, let's see, developer settings, personal access code. So here you would already have one that connected cluster one, but what you need to do is generate new token. And the only things you need to put into that token is repo in terms of access, scope, and it's an admin repo hook. And then you just generate the token. I suggest you just call it cluster one. I call it demo because I already have one called cluster one. Generate token, and there it is. And then what you need to do is to copy that, go back to cluster one, and paste it in. Let's see. And keys. So you can, in a similar way, if you want actually to run the runs on your own AWS account and resources, you put your access keys here. But for GitHub, you already have pasted mine in there, obviously, but just put add GitHub authentication token and you paste it in there, and then you save. Okay? So once you've done that, you're actually ready to go. So what you will do after that is, and I'm gonna demo this in two ways. I'm gonna actually demo it both in terms of the GUI, as I said, the user interface here on the web, and also the command line. So let's do it with both. Let me actually just see. Delete these jobs. Just do it from scratch. Okay. So very first thing you need to do is you need to add a project. And the way you do that is you click here, and you need to select your source for the project. And this is where we link to GitHub. And what the demo I'm going to show you, the multi sort of distributed run that we're going to do is on the comma.ai's open self-driving car data sets. The one where we're trying to predict the steering angle for the car based on just pure input images and ground truth. So you should be able to actually write this just like this. And for those of you that are not doing this, don't panic. This whole demo step through and walkthrough and the steps are on our website under documentation, so you can actually do this later too. So this is public repo just cloned from comma.ai under cluster one. So you just write cluster one / self-driving demo self-driving dash demo. And you say add project. And then it's added, and you have it here as one of your projects. And what you do here is you can create a job for this project. And the way you do that is very simple. So you go in here, you say which project it is. So this is the cluster one self-driving demo branch. Say we do it on the master, and latest commit, job name, SV forum, meetup, no package path needed main, and then data set. So here, that's the other good thing with cluster one. So the data set I just loaded here, you might wonder, whoa, where did that come from? So my colleague, Malo, he has already made his data set publicly available to everyone. You could make, so the sharing aspect and collaboration aspect of our platform allows you that within your own sort of enterprise account, you can make these data sets accessible to everyone else within your organization. So I'm using that. Yes, sure.
So I presume that if I'm an enterprise, I need to upload my data to your site. Is that correct?
No. You just allow us. So something I didn't demo here is if you allow us hooks, AWS hooks, we can grab it from your S3. And there's other ways as well. As I said, you just give us access to any of your other repositories, and we will pull it for you from those repositories. But of course, yes, we need the data
right
to then run the distributed job.
So besides AWS, what other connectors do you have?
As I said, it can be on-premise, so you can have your own storage that you want to do. Google, Azure, Microsoft, Azure, I mean, all the major ones where we allow hooks to pull data. So here I choose that, and this is accessible for you too as well if you want to run this job. And yes, just the ID, Python version, and here, as you can see, you can choose the framework, Jupyter, PyTorch, TensorFlow. We're gonna run TensorFlow, and let's use the latest. Package manager and that kind of stuff is things you can choose as well. We have pip as package manager here. And here, so resources for the training. This is where you decide if you want to run single node or distributed. And again, as I said, if you have set up already your own AWS account and you have your computing resources there, your nodes, and you actually want to utilize more than one node, this is where you would, if you want, run it distributed by selecting distributed. I'm going to show you how all of this is done on command line as well. You can put a time limit in hours for the job. I'm going to put this just 1 hour for now. And then how many nodes? So workers, two, and then parameter servers. And I'll talk about this, what parameter servers are, what workers are, what master nodes are, a bit further in the talk. And here's where you select. So now it has access, of course, to my resources on AWS. So I can choose any of those instances, instance types for the workers. So as you can see, there's a 8 GPU one here. These are Amazon instances. This is a 8 CPU one. 4 CPUs, 1 GPU here. So we'll run this one on, let's say just, the 8 CPUs and no GPU. And then I'm gonna run another job in parallel with GPU, so you will see the difference. The parameter server instance type, yeah, let's just use the same. Nothing fancy for now. And job description, and create and start. So what you see here immediately is that the job is started. You can look at the details. And as you can see here, it says what the type of the workers are, the parameter servers are, how many of them there are, some job parameters, we chose most of them default. And here in the events, you see where we are in the sort of process. Creation status, and then computational requirements, code cloning, data cloning, those are all done. Well, data cloning is not done, but computational requirements is still pending. And we'll get back to this in a bit further in the talk. what you can do here as well is that you can add this to TensorBoard. How many of you are familiar with TensorBoard? Right, so you can go to TensorBoard already from here. And it should show up here. Yeah, it will show up in a minute when the compilation requirements. The other thing you can see here, once this is up and running, is the outputs. Any types of logs and other outputs that you, as a data scientist, might be interested to monitor as this is ongoing. But once that is done, you will also see everything here in terms of outputs. We will return to that. But before doing that, I'm going to also start another job with the self-driving demo. So, as you saw, I already created the project, the self-driving demo project. So that's here. Now I want to run another job with different parameters and different resources. I'm going to do this one, not with the web interface, I'm going to do it with the with the command line interface, so you can see how that is done. I'm not sure if this is visible. Let's see. Can you see that?
Yeah.
Okay. So we have for that you again. There's to walk through on our website how you install our command line tool, which is called Just. That's how we want it to be for you, to just do it. So just start jobs, just create a project, etc. These are all in the documentation. So for instance, let me see. So here I want to create a job that's distributed. So with TensorFlow, as you know, there's all sorts of parameters, flags that you can pass to the jobs that you run. Just allows you to just pass those flags through our interface to the TensorFlow instance that you want to run. So here, of course, the first parameters are here related to the custom on platform, so just create job. You want to say what type of job it is, distributed in this case. And then the name of the job, I'm going to call it something else here. Let's call it new job. And then project, well, we already created the project. It was called the self-driving demo data set. So this is the data set I showed you earlier, TensorBot self-driving.
So we are creating the second job in the same project.
Yes, exactly. a project can have as many jobs as you want, and you will see what the benefit of that is. It's really, when you want to do hyperparameter tuning, for instance, you want to run many jobs in parallel, well, in parallel on ideally different resources or different computational resources, and then compare outcome. And we're going to see in a minute how that's done. Self-driving demo data is the data set, the module main TF. And then, as you know, there's other things I can provide here too as well. So time, which is the time step, I can say that that's three, let's pass it like this. And then, let's see what else.
3 hours.
Yes, and then, what was the other thing I wanted to say?
GPU?
We already set that. Well, so that is set by the nodes that we select. So, here if I don't select that, let's see. Actually, let me do it this way. So I run this here. And then it should show up here. Yeah, second job. And then before I start it, I can actually go in and edit things here. So, right, so these are the type of flags I can pass here, right? Batch size, time, steps, so. Alright. Let's just put time 3 and maybe batch. So the job is obviously not started until I tell it to start. Okay. So I can start the job from the command line as well. So like this, just start job, and then the path to the job, which is the self-driving demo, second job. And as you can see, it's not started here yet, but if I refresh this.
Oh, I think you started the wrong job. You started the second job, should be new.
Oh, thank you. Good catch there. New job. Thank you. There we go. Okay, that one started as well. So I can add this to TensorBoard as well. And now let's see. Let's see the first one, how far has it come? Outputs. So we have some outputs here, as you can see. Okay, the parameter server, worker 1 and worker 2. Oops, sorry, worker 0, worker 1. But I think they haven't started actually to... Probably hasn't run through the first epoch yet. But you will see that it's been running for 11 minutes. And then just for the sake of it, I'm just going to create another job here with like real strong computing power. We'll call this the best job. Hopefully it will be the best.
Clone the jobs?
Yes, yeah. I just wanted to walk, yeah, you can actually just clone it and then just change things. I wanted to just run this again so you see. Alright, let's see. We actually had another instance that had 8 GPUs, but one of my colleagues might have removed it, if they're doing stuff with it right now. Okay. Well, we'll run this one then. And make this as well. So unfortunately, now I'm just running it distributed on CPUs, but it would be, the only difference would be that I would have those instances with GPUs and you would just create that in or choose them and create the job. That would be it. No description needed here. Okay, create a star. So here, you see for the best job, we'll add this to TensorFlow as well. And we'll come back to this. Probably nothing there yet. Oh, new job is there. I'm gonna write this one. Details here, outputs. Oh, it actually already has some. Okay, so if I select that, we'll come back to this, and you will see some of the results. All right, let's go back to the slides. We'll return to that. Those jobs. All right, so distributed deep learning. The whole point is to run it on distributed infrastructure, right? So the prerequisites here is that you have already run at least a deep learning model. And some experience with TensorFlow would help as well. So why do you want to do this? As we said, we want to train more models in parallel, bigger models, and simply do it faster. And these three all translate into the three sort of use cases of parallelism, or versions of parallelism, which is experiment parallelism, model parallelism, and data parallelism. And as you know, experiment parallelism is, for instance, for hyperparameter tuning, when you have reasons to run the same model with different configurations, parameters and whatnot on different machines concurrently, and then in the end compare them to see which one's the best. So loss function there is sort of your loss function comparison is your ultimate goal. And this is sort of what we're doing in that demo that we'll come back to. Model parallelism is a slightly different purpose. Your motivation is that your model is just too big to to fit into one GPU or CPU. What you do is that you typically divide the model. We'll get into the details of this, how you do that. But divide the model into different parts, different graph, really, and run each of those separately on a different node. The challenge there is how the message passing between these different nodes happens. So across the sort of big neural network that you're training, forward propagation and backward propagation needs to happen across different nodes, not just, it happens, of course, for the whole network, but because the network is distributed, you actually have to do the propagation maths across different nodes. And the challenge there, of course, is this note here that people layers, inherently it becomes asynchronous because these deep, or synchronous, because the deeper layers have to wait for the first layers to finish. And that's doing forward propagation. Doing backward propagation, it's the opposite, right? It's the shallower layers that have to wait for the deep ones. Because they obviously, it's happening all in serial. Data parallelism is has similar characteristics to model parallelism, but here, the goal is just training time optimization. So you have a lot of data that you need to crunch through, and it's the same model, it's just one model, and let's say you've already decided what your optimal parameters are, you've done your hyperparameter tuning, but now you want to run it seriously with your full data set, and it's just a lot. And let's say you have a business where you actually need to train these models regularly. That's where data parallelism comes in. So you have the same model on every GPU, but your data that trains the model on each separate GPU or node is different. So it's divided and shared. The challenge there is how do you, once you train these, the same model but with different data, how do you consolidate that? That's where averaging of the weights and whatnot comes in when you actually decide what's the final model. If we have these different ones that are the same one, but slightly different because of, they've been trained with different data.
Oh, quick question. So yeah. Which of these three is actually kind of used in practice or more popular?
I would say all of them, but they're used at different phases of your development. Experiment parallelism is used at the very early stage where you even don't know what kind of model you want. I mean, the example here is hyperparameter tuning, but I can imagine that there's other reasons where you want to run widely different models because you have different hypotheses that you want to run.
Right.
So this is really hypothesis benchmarking.
Yeah.
This is distributed because we're running a separate job on each GPU.
Right, correct.
So it's not distributed, it's just the separate job on each GPU.
Well, it's parallelism. That's why I didn't call it distributed. It's just parallelism. You distributed your experiments, but yeah, there's no consolidation or anything. You're absolutely right. These two other ones, the model parallelism and data parallelism, is more distributed type of computing where you actually have to consolidate certain data in the end. So, yeah.
So can those three parallelism can all run together, or they have to be completely separate?
Run together in what sense?
I mean, when I create something, can some of those run this one, or can it run in error?
Absolutely. I mean,
okay.
As long as they are not competing for resources,
okay.
They can run in parallel. Indeed.
So
that's, yeah.
For the model parallelism, like say you have three instances here, are you dividing network into maybe, like let's say, nine layers? Like are you training three layers per instance? Or how do you do that?
For the model parallelism?
Yeah.
So the idea is that you typically divide it so that you have different layers, and if it's really huge, you might even actually divide it so that even within each layer, you have multiple nodes. I mean, this is where, how Google and Uber and the big play Facebook does it, I'm assuming, because when you have models that are so big that even a layer is too big to fit in one node, or let's say you have reasons to run it really fast and then you actually want to divide it into a pair of nodes. But yes, each layer becomes a different node.
So it sounds like, and then between those nodes, you have to communicate all the ways the derivatives or?
And TensorFlow, thanks to Google, has a neat way of doing that with the Google RPC. So we'll talk about that in a sec. But yes, that's the challenge.
Okay. And for the data parallels.
Yep.
Like say for example, you have three sets, and are you each one model have 1 million parameters or weights? Are you doing like 3 million weights and?
Very good question. So you can actually do this, and I'll come to it in a second. You can actually do it both synchronous and asynchronous, and there's benefits and drawbacks with each. Yes, you can wait for all the models to finish and then update your well-fold deltas and then update that.
Yeah,
that's the synchronous one. And then the asynchronous, you just whenever one of them is finished with one epoch, you update the main one based on what that one concluded in that epoch. There's, as you will see, there's drawbacks and benefits with both approaches depending on your approach. But yeah.
So on data parallelism, oftentimes we need to randomize and shuffle the data to fit in the different nodes.
Yes.
So I didn't see that in your demo.
There is a parameter that I didn't provide called shuffle, where you can actually tell it to shuffle the data. I knew that the data set is already pretty shuffled, so I didn't do that there. But yes, you need to do that. The whole issue of, and I actually have a couple of slides on that, the issue of sharding and shuffling of the data is taken care of by TensorFlow's new updated
data
set class has these methods built in now, so you don't even have to worry about the pipelining basically of the data. You'll see that in a second. So let me jump a bit deeper into these things. Sure.
So it's kind of related to that one. I mean, this is like a classic parallel distributed systems problem.
Yeah.
If this is actually for large data sets, from being a compute bound, this would become an I/O bound job, right? And it is usually a lot worse.
Yes, indeed.
So
indeed.
You will not gain anything with big data sets if you have to shuffle around so much data.
Yeah, and that's really the part of the headache that we take care of at Plus One, because we optimize for that in terms of, well, there's, as I said, there's TensorFlow built-in tools for that make sure that you don't waste any cycles waiting for large data. But there's also a lot more you can do in terms of when you schedule your jobs and you schedule the workers. If you're running multiple experiments in parallel, you can actually utilize that, and this is what we do at Plus One, that wait time to have that node run something else. So there's all sorts of benefits and gains if you are actually running many experiments where the waiting time can actually be utilized.
But it's again a very classical problem, right? I mean, always finding the job to fit into the gap which you have, and it's a bigger problem than what you are solving. People have been working on that for like 50 years.
Absolutely. No. People have been working on it a very long time, and we're really not reinventing
any of that.
Yet. No. All right. So distributed TensorFlow. How does that work? Well, you've already seen some of these concepts in my demo earlier, but essentially you have three parts. You have the parameter server, the PS, you have the workers, and then you typically have some sort of master that coordinates the training operations. The parameter server is responsible for holding all the model parameters and updating in response to incoming gradients. So this is especially when you're running the data parallelism, model parallelism, this is important. Workers are the actual workers running the jobs. They do everything like calculating the loss, performing the back propagation, and sending these updates to the parameter server. So for instance, everything that you will see on the tensor board, hopefully in a few minutes, is from the master node or master worker.
So do you have any best practices of like what is the ratio between parameter servers and workers to deploy?
That's a good question. We with our clients, we've seen that it's very hard to give a like rule of thumb best practice. It really depends on it depends on the ratio of I assume you could actually maybe develop a best practice or rule of thumb, because it depends on the ratio of the length of each epoch, each run of the data through any worker, and how many workers you have, and how many epochs you want to run. So the more granular that is, so the more data and updating that needs to be sent to the master worker, the more master nodes, having more master nodes helps.
So keeping that in mind, is it okay to get away with parameter servers not having GPUs and just putting the GPUs on workers?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah. For sure. 10 more minutes. Okay. I'm going to speed through this. Okay. So this is someone asked about this, the synchronous asynchronous training. And this is, I think I just said this. Let's see, I have 10 minutes. Okay. Very quickly then. Typically, what the steps involved in doing this distributed job creation is, you define a cluster of jobs and tasks. In TensorFlow, that's typically done in the TF train cluster spec. So here, for instance, we have two tasks, task 0, task 1, and then you set up your server. Set up connection between them. That's where the Google's RPC, gRPC comes in, the remote procedure call protocol of Google. And that is sort of Google's solution with sort of all the best practices that over the past 40, 50 years have been developed for this kind of parallelism procedure.
How will Google actually do this? This is the task partitioning thing should be done by the originator, right? What are the boundaries of data dependencies? How to create isolated tasks? Isn't that the job of the creator?
Yes, but I mean,
it's a classic problem of the supercomputers, right? You had to create custom.
Yeah, built into TensorFlow, basically.
Yeah.
That's my point, yeah. Yeah, no, we're not reinventing anything. We're just making it easier for you to utilize these tools. That's it. And then you assign your model to the parameter server and the workers as such. I'm not gonna go through the code here. And then you configure and launch. These are exactly the things you saw me do, the steps, but this is sort of telling you how it works in the back. So the delta of the weights are to the parameter server, of course. We'll jump over this. So this is hopefully what I will show you, but you get this speed up, linear step speed up. What's important to remember here is that the scaling, you won't necessarily get 10 times the speed up with 10 times the CPUs or GPUs nodes. There's obviously always an efficiency loss, so it's just like, engineers. You don't get 10 times more efficient company or productive company if you multiply the number of engineers with 10. There's some efficiency losses here. there's actually a theoretical bound to it as well. But I'll show that on results. Data pipelines, I'll jump over this. Debugging. Some debugging tips and tricks. This might come in handy. I got a few minutes left. Absolutely always in any debugging, have a subset of your data set ready because you want to run it fast and small, nimble sets. Run it at first thing you do, run it on one node that you know that should work. So if it doesn't work there, you might have a problem at a more fundamental level with your code. And then when you want to see why it's failing on distributed trials, run multiple of these. So does the job always fail at the same time, like in different on different nodes? Might be corrupted data or a memory leak. Does the job fail doing a specific operation? So maybe you should introduce some checkpoints in your code. Does the job always fail because of the same worker? Maybe there's some issues with that worker. It's absolutely not, we've seen it with our clients who run on-premise. It's very common that you have hardware issues that only show their heads when you run these intensive jobs. And then you can actually run an emulation of a distributed training locally. This doesn't do justice to, like, basically if you pass all these other tests and it's still failing, you might want to do this emulation because it might be something more conceptually wrong with how you're running your experiment. Basically, what you want to know is the problem or bug coming from the code, from the cluster, or both. And yeah, causes that we have seen are common with our clients is networking issues. The workers don't really find each other, or they don't find the process server, parameter server. Missing pods, so have all the workers and jobs actually started. And bad initialization is another one. But this is common when you're running many experiments and you don't clear your logs and you have artifacts from previous stuff you've done, previous experiments you've done. So this meta graph that you have in your checkpoints, you need to clear those. Anyways, so known issues that the community has reported is that with TensorFlow 1.4, training sometimes stops after a few hours. So this is something you want to watch out for. On cluster one, we actually, if that happens, we restart those jobs automatically for you. Someone asked about the worker parameter server master server ratio. Really, the best answer is to benchmark and test that. Trial and error. Am I at time? Okay, 5 minutes. Excellent. Infrastructure requirements. Actually, let's jump over this. This is the, I think you guys know that. Let's talk the last couple of minutes about the future. So, as we heard one of the members of the audience say, you know, the issue of parallelism and distributed processes have been around as a research topic for many decades. And in fact, the concept of a parameter server worker is an old one. This is not something, you know, folks at Google came up with, or maybe some of those folks that came up with it now work at Google, but Igor Severkin, who is a senior software machine learning engineer at Google, did make this statement. And it's a legitimate doubt because there's some design challenges when you set up these kind of systems, distributed systems. There's of course performance considerations. Sure, you have speed up versus single node, and scalability limitations. The switching cost is another challenge because when you switch to this kind of system, you typically have within an organization some sort of code change, architecture change, rework that you need to do. It doesn't come for free. And infrastructure is obvious. If you want to run jobs distributed, you actually need the infrastructure to do so. Uber actually took on some of these things and tried to see how far they could, these challenges, tried to see how far they could take it with Horovod, which is their framework for running distributed deep learning. And they benchmarked obviously against distributed TensorFlow. And this is all reduce based. If you're familiar with all reduce, some of you are, let's see, nodding. They basically showed that they could achieve more than 100% improvement in certain cases compared to distributed TensorFlow. This is on the Pascal GPUs of NVIDIA. Ideal here is it's not really it's the absolute theoretical upper boundary. It's like what's not actually possible in practice, meaning you multiply your number of GPUs with the time, the time it takes on one GPU with the number of GPUs you have, which is like the theoretical ideal. There's no way of actually achieving that in practice, but you can get very close to it, as Horovod has demonstrated that they do. And then we're actually working on supporting Horovod on Cluster One as well. There's been a lot of popular demand for that. Other noteworthy sort of efforts here are Baidu's distributed deep learning implementation. I'd recommend you to check that out as well. You should also check out the mirrored strategy of TensorFlow that was actually unveiled at the TensorFlow Developer Summit recently. Let's go back to the demo, the few minutes we have left, and see how that's doing. Look at the details of this job, for instance. Let's see the outputs. Strange, this one, I don't know what happened. Okay, we're about this. That explains why there was nothing in those drops.
Yeah, and you gotta set that, yeah.
Okay. Let's see. Okay. some examples at least, see on the job it's running. So this is the, if you're familiar with the comma.ai self-driving datasets, this is, the green is the predicted steering angle, blue is ground truth. And this will populate with all the outputs throughout the training process. So you will see how this gets better and better. Yes?
So what about fault tolerance? If one of the nodes goes down, will the job get transferred to some other live node?
We actually don't do that because we might interfere with whatever is scheduled on that node. So we actually just restart that node. If it keeps getting dying, because that can happen, then we queue the job and transfer and basically do a rebalancing where we transfer the queue of jobs on the remaining nodes that are alive.
So the user doesn't have to worry about it. I just need to find the job.
No, not at all. In fact, our users, we have people in the client companies we work with who are barely machine learning savvy. They just know that we have this training data, they know the basics, this is the labels, we want to run it at scale, we want to do it this fast. They just know they want it within like 24 hours and nothing to worry about in terms of infrastructure or job scheduling, any of that. Yep, so, yes.
Is there a way to limit the resources used per worker? So instead of having one worker using one GPU, could I have two workers share the GPU, knowing that they're not going to maximize?
Yeah, as a matter of fact, so Cluster One platform does that if you, by default, if you just give it one worker, mm-hmm. and you say you want to run something distributed, if that worker has, like the it has multiple cores on that single machine. Yeah, absolutely. We distribute across those cores.
All right.
Yeah.
Okay, so we have to end the talk, and if you have an additional question, feel free to